Okay, so good morning again. Today we will go on to study the next assignment, and that is nothing but audio amplifier, right? So before going to that details, we will see how it is divided in various blocks. So the first block of that audio amplifier circuitry, it is signal source. For example, like mic, right? So mic is the signal source for that audio amplifier. The next one is pre-amplifier. I will go on to explain in detail the difference between this pre-amplifier, then driver stage and power amplifier, right? All three are the, actually, these three are the amplifiers. But why there is need of pre-amplifier, or without pre-amplifier, can we amplify the signal? All that things we will go on to discuss later on, okay? Then next block is tone and volume control. Then there is a driver stage, and last stage is power amplifier, which is interface to our load, and that load is basically in that audio amplifier circuitry, that load is speaker right now. So see, that signal source that is mostly used as a mic, it is a very weak signal source, very weak in terms of what? Its power providing capacity, or we can say in terms of voltage, its level is also very, very small. Right now, you might have studied that mic in your mechatronics, right? So, is it sensor or transducer? Just let me know. Mic is a sensor or transducer?
Sir, it's a transducer.
It's a transducer, very nice. Why you are calling it as a transducer?
Because
It
it converts the
converts
electrical energy. Okay.
yes, it converts
electrical energy into physical energy.
electrical into physical or
Analog.
sound signal into electrical signal.
Sound into electrical thing.
Sound into
Mic, yes, sound into electrical signal. So that converted electrical signal, it is very weak signal in terms of its amplitude as well as current rating. And that's why there is need of pre-amplifier. Now we'll see what is exactly the difference between that pre-amplifier and the amplifier circuits you studied during your second year in EDC. That is common source MOSFET amplifier, you already studied. Practically also, we verified so many AC parameters of that amplifier. For example, like its voltage gain, input impedance, output impedance, frequency response, bandwidth, and all that, right? So see, if you can recall, during that practical, while studying common source MOSFET amplifier, I suggested apply the input equals to 100 millivolt peak, right? But over there also, nobody asked me why 100 millivolt? Why we can't apply 1 millivolt, right? So conventional amplifier circuit, which you studied, requires some more strong signal source. Then and then, if you can recall that DC load line, operating point, shifting of that operating point on DC load line, etc. If that signal source is sufficiently strong, then and then the shifting of that operating point occurs. Otherwise, significant shifting will not going on to occur, and hence we can't obtain the output. The same things today during our practical session, we will going on to verify what is the difference between that conventional amplifier and pure amplifier. Based on, we can say, op-amp, we can use it as a pre-amplifier, right? So that pre-amplifier, it is capable to amplify the weak signals. Okay. Now, its disadvantage is it will not go on to amplify that signal with a sufficient or large amplitude. And that's why, again, there is need to process that somewhat amplified signal. The purpose of this pre-amplifier is what? To amplify the weak signal, as well as if there is somewhat noise, that also will go on to filter under this first stage. And somewhat amplified signal, it will get forwarded to process by the next stages. So the next stage I drawn here, that is tone and volume control. That means how much output volume we required, that generally we said from this stage, right? Now simple potentiometer or variable resistor is there. So by varying its resistance, we can change the volume or the output, right? So that we can say the volume gets controlled. Okay. Now there is one more block I shown here. It is shown by dotted line. That means in all audio amplifiers, it might not be over here right now. That means the volume control in few audio amplifiers, we have to do it manually, and in few cases, once we set the level of that output signal, even if there is change in the volume of or the level of input signal source, the system takes the control and accordingly produces the output. And that's why it is known as feedback control. So this feedback control, it is used to set or to keep the volume level automatically, or to keep the control on that output level, right? Then there is a driver stage. Basically, this stage, it is preferred to interface two stages with each other. As it is a multi-stage amplifier, we can call it as a multi-stage amplifier. You might have studied the various configurations of BJT during your first year, or after diploma students might have studied during their diploma course, right? So which are the various configurations of BJT we can use as an amplifier? So there are three configurations: common collector, common base, and common emitter. Common emitter configuration, it is mostly preferred for voltage amplification, while common collector, its voltage gain is maximum unity. That's why we are calling it as a voltage follower also. And common base configuration, it is mostly preferred to interface to two stages with each other. See why there is need to interface two stages by using this driver stage. Okay. You might have studied for ideal voltage amplifier, if we look towards the pre-amplifier stage, right now, it is a voltage amplifier. For ideal voltage amplifier, input impedance is infinite, that is RI, output impedance is zero. And practically, the design should be done in such a way that its input impedance should be as high as possible, so that any signal source can source the signal to that pre-amplifier circuit, right? Otherwise, if its input impedance is poor, that signal source works on loading condition. So to avoid the loading of signal source, the input impedance of that voltage amplifier, here it is pre-amplifier, it should be as high as possible, and its output impedance, it should be as low as possible. When its output impedance will be as low as possible, it can deliver a maximum power to the next stage. Right. Now see, if this driver stage is not there between pre-amplifier and last stage, that is power amplifier. Power amplifier, again, it amplifies the current or overall power, we can see. That is the basic difference between conventional amplifier and power amplifier. In power amplifier, voltage amplification is not that much high level, but current amplification is very high. So that we can say the total delivered power to the load, it will be very high right now. So see, for impedance matching now, we can say as the output impedance of pre-amplifier is very low and input impedance of power amplifier, we are trying to keep it at very high level. So if these two stages are interfaced, connected with each other directly, then it is known as mismatching of impedances. And if there is a mismatching between that two stages related to the impedances, then maximum power transfer cannot take place. So to have the maximum power transfer from one stage to next stage, there is need of that intermediate stage. And that is nothing but driver stage. Okay. Now, last one, that is power amplifier. After diploma students might have studied various power amplifiers. Can anyone? I will give the hint. First type of that power amplifier, that is class A. Now remaining, I will expect from your side. You already studied it, I know it. after diploma. Is there anyone can answer for this? Various types of power amplifiers. First one is class A.
Class A, B. Class A, class B, class B.
Yes, very nice. Class A, class B. Third one is class AB. Then fourth one is class C. And one more is there, but it is mostly used in digital circuits. That is class D. Okay. That class D, it amplifies only that pulsating DC. So its output is either zero or directly high level. So we are not going on to consider over here, this class B. Remaining four are important in our application. That is class A, second one is class B, then class AB and class C. Okay. Do you know how it is classified as various class A, class B, class C, class AB? That classification is done basically by what? Anyone? Okay. So
frequency range.
What?
Frequency range.
I'm not getting what you are saying. Okay.
Handling power of frequency.
Okay. Okay. So see, the classification basically it is done based on the location of that operating point, Q point. And you all people already studied about that DC load line and position of Q point. Right now, in our previous application of transistor, that is as a switch, we located that Q point either in the cutoff region or in the switch on region. In general, purposely I am saying that switch as on. Why? Because in case of MOSFET, that region is known as ohmic region, and in case of BJT, that region is known as a saturation region. So being on switch, that transistor, it should get bias, it should get force into its either ohmic or saturation. Right now, if it is MOSFET or BJT respectively. While that middle region, in case of BJT, it is known as an active region, and in case of MOSFET, it is known as a saturation region. So that middle region, it is preferred as an amplifier. So that Q point, generally we are saying that Q point, it should be at the center of that DC load line, right? So I will show you what is that DC load line and how that Q point is located according to our need right now. So we'll take the example of BJT. So I will take here VCE and over here IC. Right. So this will be our IC max, and that is nothing but VCC by RC, that resistor RC, collector resistor will be going to limit that collector current. It should not get exceed beyond the maximum current handling capacity of that transistor. And over here VCE max, that will be equals to VCC. Right. So generally we are saying that operating point, it should be at the center, at Q point. Correct now? Accordingly, the biasing of that transistor is done, means in the absence of input signal, that base current value IB should be this much, which is known as a IBQ. So you are already familiar with this thing. Okay. And if no signal is there, then across that transistor, whatever VCE we are getting, that is known as a VCQ, and respective value of IC, this is known as ICQ. Agree with this output characteristic of BJT? I shown only single curve and I plotted one DC load line over there. Right. So see, if this operating point is selected exactly at the center, what is the significance of that operating point at the center? Whenever we are applying any input signal source like this, According to the applied input signal, at operating point, it gets shifted on the disallowed line, but it remains within the active region, so that the obtain output voltage we can obtain like this, somewhat amplified, right now. Is it okay? Similarly, over here, I see collector current also will going on to change, and we'll have the amplitude somewhat like this. Is it okay? This is nothing but IC, right now. Here we are calling it as IC max. This one is IC min, and this one is ICQ. So see, you will observe that collector current never becomes zero. It goes minimum up to over here, but never goes to zero. Are you agree with this? So here we can say, if the transistor is biased exactly at the center of the DC load line, then it never gets turned off. That means transistor always remains on. Only its conduction gets varied, either to the quiescent level, or its maximum level, or its minimum level. But it is there. That conduction is there. Are you agree with this? If the operating point is selected at the center of load line, what we can say, the transistor always remains in conduction during the complete cycle of applied input signal source. This one. This is nothing but our V in, right now. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So see, as transistor always remains in conduction, what may be the disadvantage? Just think on it. Throughout the complete cycle, as transistor remains in conduction, can we say there will be more power dissipation? Yes. As transistor remains continuously in conduction, there is continuous power dissipation across the transistor. Right? Just try to correlate it, power dissipation more, with efficiency. Efficiency generally is determined by taking the ratio of obtained output power divided by applied input power. Okay? So, as already I told, that transistor remains continuously in conduction, there is more power dissipation, and hence efficiency gets degraded, remember. Power dissipation occurs continuously across the transistor, that's why efficiency gets degraded. Okay. Now, so remember, if that operating point is selected at the center, such type of power amplifier is known as a class A power amplifier. Got it? Then the second one, if we selected that operating point exactly on the x-axis, if it is over here, check it. And what will be going to happen? Just try by yourself. I will remove it now. Now the transistor is biased exactly on the x-axis instead of at the center of that load line. Okay. That means we have to apply the input signal source over here. See what will happen. During the positive half cycle of that input, that operating point, it will get shifted within its active region, right now. But during negative half, that transistor will remain continuously in cutoff region. Yes or no? During negative half of input, the transistor will remain into cutoff region. Now, just check what will be the output. So we will have the output only negative half cycle. We are considering that BJT in C configuration, and when it is in C configuration, there is 180 degree phase shift between applied input signal and the output obtained output voltage. Right. Similarly, during negative half, as I said, that transistor remains continuously in cutoff region. What will be the output voltage across transistor? That means VCE. It will remain VCC, right now. So you will have that output voltage equals to VCC. And later on, again, next positive half cycle will start, and we can obtain the output like this. Agree with this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So see, if that operating point is selected exactly on the x-axis, such type of amplifier is known as class B amplifier. Okay. Now we'll compare with class A. See, over here, looking towards the output obtained signal, we can say there is somewhat loss of the applied input signal. This much part of that input signal gets lost. Right now, we can't process it. But as the conduction of transistor is only for one half cycle, okay, that is during positive half of input to obtain the output as negative half. As the transistor conduction is only for half cycle, we can say power dissipation will be low as compared to previous case. That is class A. Agree with this? For remaining half, that is during negative half, transistor remains into cutoff region. That means it remains off. Only during positive half of input, that transistor works into its active region. And hence, power dissipation, if we compare it with class A, power dissipation decreases. If power dissipation gets decreased, can we say efficiency will get increased? Yes, because already I told efficiency is nothing but obtained output power divided by applied input power, right? So the efficiency of class B, it is more as compared to class A. Okay. So from after diploma students, can anyone explain how much is the efficiency of class A and how much is for class B? If you can recall, you already studied it. Can anyone? Okay. So remember, for class A, that efficiency is almost 25%. That we can improve by somewhat modification, but remains maximum up to 50%. Okay. While for class B, it is almost 75%. But what is the disadvantage of class B? Half signal, it gets lost. We can't process it. Right now. So that much information which is available over here, it will get lost. So that is a disadvantage. But that we can overcome. Okay. Means we can overcome that loss by using a separate transistor to process this negative half cycle and separate transistor to process this positive half cycle. And if we process it, just like I said, then that class B, it is again subdivided as. Can anyone? Have you heard about push-pull amplifier?
Yes, sir.
Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
So that class B push-pull, class B push-pull complementary symmetry, etc., you might have heard it, right now. So by using such type of configurations in that power amplifier for class B, we can overcome such type of losses which occurs by using a single transistor. Okay. why it is known as push-pull, that also I will be going to explain later on. Whenever we will going to study that circuits separately. Okay, so at this stage only we have to learn about the various types of that power amplifiers, right? Okay, but before going to that, just we are up to class B push-pull or that complementary symmetry. One of the type of distortion is there. Again, can anyone can recall one type of distortion? It occurs in class B amplifier. No one. Okay, that also I will going to explain in detail later on.
Crossover distortion.
Yes, very nice. That crossover distortion, it occurs if we prefer that class B push-pull or complementary symmetry, but that can also we overcome by a particular type of biasing by using two diodes. If you can recall, that diodes are connected in series at the base terminal of transistor and are commonly powered by same VCC. So there is continuous voltage drop of almost 0.7 volts, and by that we can overcome this crossover distortion which occurs in class B configuration. Okay. Now third one, that is class AB. Now it's very simple. Where will be the operating point? Just looking towards this configuration. As it is titled as class AB, that means operating point, it will not be exactly at the center as well as it will not be on the x-axis. It will be somewhat above the x-axis and below the center of that diode line, right? So see, we can show that class AB somewhat by selecting that operating point over here. It is not exactly at the center as well as it is not exactly on the x-axis. It is over here. Now see, if we apply that input signal again for this configuration, you will observe during positive half of input, there is a sufficient space to get shift that operating point from here up to over here in the active region. But during negative half of input, we can say this much part, during this much part of input signal, that transistor gets enter into its cutoff region, right? And we'll check what nature of output in terms of voltage we can obtain by using such type of configuration. So here, positive half cycle will get completely processed as transistor continuously remains in the active region, and that's why we can obtain that complete negative as it is to the output with somewhat amplification. And during negative half of input, as transistor enters into the cutoff region, some part gets saturated like this. Is it visible properly?
Yes, sir.
The positive output partially it gets clip off. That means somewhat information again it gets lost, right? That also we can overcome. So various circuitries are there. Then power dissipation and efficiency. What you think? Power dissipation as compared to class A will be more or less or same?
Less.
It will be somewhat less, but it will be greater than class B. Power dissipation, it will be somewhat less than class A, but greater than class B, because the conduction angle of transistor, it is somewhat more as compared to class B, but less as compared to class B, right? And hence, efficiency, it is somewhat between class A and class B. Agree? As the power dissipation is in between class A and class B, the efficiency also remains within this range. Okay. Now we'll switch to class C, fourth one. And for that, we'll consider that operating point is below somewhat x-axis. Instead of keeping it on the x-axis or above the x-axis or at the center, if we keep that operating point somewhat, suppose over here, below the x-axis, that is in the cutoff region, and if we apply again the input signal as it is, this is our Vin. Okay, now you will observe up to over here, even if that input signal is positive, up to over here the transistor remains into cutoff region, and later on it will be going to enter into the active region, right? Means the shifting will be going to take place over here, and during negative half of input it continuously remains in the cutoff region. Are you agree? Is it visible properly?
Yes sir.
Okay, so see, in this case, that is for class C, negative half completely gets lost, as well as some part of positive also gets lost, right? Only this much part of the input signal we are processing, right? So the losses are more related to the applied input signal in case of class C, but conduction angle, it is less than 180 degrees. That means conduction angle is less than class B. Okay, and that's why power dissipation, it will be minimum, and hence efficiency of class C, it is maximum. It is up to 95%. Got it?
Yes sir.
Okay, so all these are about that last stage, and that is nothing but power amplifier. Now we'll see why there is need of power amplifier, or how that need gets fulfilled by these various power amplifiers, right? So see, in audio amplifier, basically what is the load?
Speaker.
Load is, yes, it is a speaker. Almost you people have seen such type of load, right? Now in various functions we are using that DJ and all that, right? So all that are the speakers. Do you know about the impedance of speaker or the resistance of speaker? Okay, now see what is there inside the speaker. There is one magnet. Around that magnet one coil is wounded, and it is, that coil is powered by the output of our amplifier circuit simply, right? So when that time varying signal passes through that coil, it gets vibrate, and that vibration of coil, it is provided to the diaphragm which is used in that speaker, so that vibration gets converted into sound signal. Okay, that is somewhat about the speaker, how it is constructed. So basically we are powering whatever the coil is there around the magnet of that speaker like this. So that coil have very very low resistance. Coil have very low resistance. You might have seen on that speaker, on the magnet it is written 4 ohm or just 8 ohm, etc. Okay, so if it is written as 4 ohm on that magnet, just imagine it is as good as zero resistive load, right? Now and when it will be very low resistive or almost zero resistive load, how much current that load will going on to consume from our power amplifier? The current consumption by such type of load, very low impedance load, just like 4 ohm, that current is very high. Okay, what is, as the current consumed by the load due to low impedance is very high, our power amplifier should be capable to provide such type of high power. That means a sufficient amplitude, voltage amplitude, as well as a very large current, it should get delivered to the load, then and then it will be able to operate properly. Okay, otherwise if that power amplifier is not capable to provide such type of high load current, then that power amplifier itself operates on overloading condition and gets damaged due to heat generated across that power amplifier circuit. So in that systems like DJ and all that, most of the power dissipation, it occurs in that last tool, that is power amplifier. Okay, What is about the load? Why there is need of power amplifier? Okay, because that power amplifier is capable to provide much more or very large power, which is required to operate the load, and that is nothing but speaker. Okay. Already I explained about this driver stage. I given the example of common base configuration. In CD configuration, you might have seen its input impedance and output impedance are almost same. Okay, so it can get easily interface with the amplifier, and towards the output side, it again gets easily interface with power amplifier, or we can say the maximum power transfer through such type of stages is where becomes very simple. That's why it is required over there. Now we will switch to discrete amplifier. Now you are well familiar with about this DC load line and everything. So see, if the shifting of operating point Q point takes place, then and then we can obtain the output as time varying output right now. And if not, then the output will remain constant. That means like this. So see, if my applied input signal is very weak, a very small amplitude signal in microvolts, because the signal source like mic, it generates the signal in microvolts, the electrical signal. That transducer, it converts the sound energy into electrical energy, but the amplitude is very small. That is in few microvolts. Okay. So see, in our conventional amplifiers, if such type of very low amplitude signal is applied across that amplifier, then that operating point shifting will not going on to occur. And if operating point do not get shift, then we can't obtain the output, right? So such type of pre-amplifier, basically by design by using op-amp, which are very sensitive, or we can say can operate at very low input signal level, takes the care about such type of low amplitude input signal and provides the output sufficiently large. Okay, sufficiently large means how much it will be again to satisfy the requirement of this driver stage, right? For CD configuration also, to provide it with somewhat amplification, there is need of somewhat large signal as compared to pre-amplifier. Right, so that pre-amplifier, as it provides somewhat amplification, that is sufficient to drive this driver stage. Again, it will be able to amplify with somewhat amplitude. It should be in such a way that it should satisfy the input requirement of power amplifier. What is when a sufficient amplitude input signal gets applied to the power amplifier? Next, care for drive the load, it gets taken by the power amplifier. That means it will be able to boost the current rating of that signal also, so that this complete system works accordingly, right? Is it okay? This middle block, that is tone and volume control, either we can change manually the level of that output, or nowadays some systems are there, even if, see that signal source, I will say here, if the person gets changed in front of that mic, person to person, amplitude levels are different, right now? Voice levels are different. So even if that person gets changed, that means if high level voice signal person is there, and if we set manually this tone and volume control somewhat at particular level, so that we are getting the output, we can say sufficiently large. If that person with high level voice signal is there, by the preset value of this volume and tone control, the output may get exceed. Right? So manually, generally what we are doing, we are keeping the control on that output manually by changing that potentiometer. Right? Again, next condition, if another person is there having somewhat very low voice amplitude, then there is need to increase the volume of output, right? But in few systems, Nowadays, there is auto control. Even if that person gets changed accordingly, the preset value of output, for example, like if 50 dB output sound level is we set, even if the input signal source level gets changed, the system takes auto control so that the output it remains 50 dB. Otherwise, manually we have to change it. Got it? Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so in the next lecture, we will see about that details for power amplifiers. And during our practical session, first of all, we will complete that our previous remaining assignment. Hope so. Today, you people will be able to complete it. And in the next practical, we prepared 2 to 3 amplifiers. First one is by using that MOSFET, then by using BJT, and by using op-amp, right? Now one more thing remaining over here. See, while processing that input signal, you are already familiar with the frequency response of an amplifier. Generally, we are plotting that frequency response like this, right now. Frequency versus gain. Now, just let me know, as you are well familiar with FL and FH, that is lower cutoff frequency and higher cutoff frequency, right? While designing that preamplifier or that driver stage or power amplifier, we have to take care about the FL and FH of all three stages. Right now? So just let me know what care we should take about FL and FH for all these three amplifiers. Can anyone? Answer is very simple. Just try it. No one. Okay. What is the signal source? Mic. And what is the sound signal source? Human being. Right now. So what is the frequency range of human being?
The FL will be 20 hertz and FH will be 20 kilohertz.
Yes, yes, yes. Very nice. While designing that amplifiers, we have to take care about FL and FH. That means it should remain within audio range, audio frequency range. Right now. So see, where I highlighted this point over here. For example, while designing preamplifier, if you have taken the care, while designing power amplifier last stage, if its lower cutoff frequency is somewhat greater than 20 hertz or less than 20, and FH is somewhat less than 20 kilohertz, that means its bandwidth will get reduced, right? And there may be a signal source having his or her frequency like a 20 kilohertz, right? So that much information which is delivered by that person at frequencies of 20 kilohertz, it will get lost, right? Why it will get lost? Because if the power amplifier having its FH is somewhat less than 20 kilohertz, or we can't obtain the output with that sufficient amplitude, because it will be able to work below this FH, right? So while designing all three amplifiers, the care it should get taken about its lower cutoff and higher cutoff frequencies. That's all, right? While input and output, input requirements are different, output is also different. In case of preamplifier, input requirement, even if it is very, very small, we know it will be able to amplify it. But the amplification by that preamplifier, it should be done in such a way that that should be a sufficient to satisfy the requirement of this power amplifier. Input requirement, right now. And the care of load that will be taken by power amplifier. That's right. Right? So we'll stop here.